Oh, what peace I find. Here with your hand pressing close to mine. So peaceful and calm inside. Like the sea. And without saying one single word, the depths of your soul can be heard. Peace for the privilege of loving and the privilege of being loved. Ease for the ease it gives the soul and the mind. Hate is what else in your search to find yourself. See is the calm you feel if you like what you find. He is everlasting. Let this love never cease. Peace. Your love has brought me peace. So I want you to walk me. Take my hand.
Isn't that a nice song? All right. Here we go. We're starting at chapter 6. Please let me know if you're not hearing me clearly. Jumanji, quiet. Chapter 6. Prayer didn't change a thing. Mama buried herself into her church life, attending every service there was. Are y'all gonna let me read a what? Alright, hold on. Let me turn off one of these lights. I'm sorry. Because they both acting up now. There, that light is off. Now go to sleep. Now stop it. Now I can't really see. Oh, man. Pain ass 11 o'clock at night. Although it's my fault. Shut up. All right. Oh, flashlight. Gotta deal with this stuff. Don't ever get parrots. All right. Get real comfortable. I guess I gotta sit up straight. I'm skipping again. Am I skipping right now? I hope not. It's gonna skip, but okay. Okay. Hey, that should do it. Chapter 6. Prayer didn't change a thing. Mama buried herself into her church life, attending every service there was. She'd often bring us with her, except on the weeknights. On those nights, she'd hire a babysitter. She had a friend in the neighborhood who Daddy also had befriended. Her name was Louise, and she had teenage daughters. Randomly, Mama caught Daddy at Miss Louise's house drinking. She'd already had a feeling he might have been cheating on her with Miss Louise. Therefore, she confronted them about it, but they both denied it. Since Mama didn't want to start anything with him, she left the whole matter alone. On a particular night she wanted to go to church, she asked Miss Louise if her daughter could watch us. Miss Louise agreed, and while her daughter was watching us, Daddy happened to drop by. We were already in bed, and they thought we were asleep, but we heard Daddy peeking in our room. We quickly closed our eyes and pretended to be asleep. Daddy and the babysitter went into the kitchen, and we could hear Daddy whispering to the girl as she laughed. All the laughter we heard puzzled us. It sounded like he was flirting with the girl, and it sounded like she was enjoying it. Bobby and I were curious and decided to peek out from behind the curtain that hung up like a door to our bedroom. Although the kitchen was a room away, we could still see and hear them clearly. There they were at the kitchen table with Miss Louise's daughter sitting on Daddy's lap. My. We couldn't believe our eyes. Here Daddy was misbehaving with Miss Louise's daughter, and she didn't mind at all. In fact, she appeared to like it. I was shocked to see him doing this, more so that she wasn't pushing him away, but rather aroused by it. Seemed as if I'd have been planned, like they were just waiting for Mama to leave. Nonetheless, we went back to bed, promising we'd tell Mama when she returned home. And when she came home, she was surprised to see him there. Even though she wasn't expecting him, she seemed happy to see him. He'd obviously finished messing around with the babysitter and sent her home. Daddy was pleasant with Mama as Daddy went to bed. The next morning, when Mama came to wake us up for school, I couldn't wait to tell her. I quickly confessed, "Mama, Daddy was kissing and rubbing all over the babysitter, and she was laughing with him. She liked him, Mama, and he liked her too." Mama was startled. She didn't want to believe what I was telling her. She warned, "You shouldn't lie like that on your daddy. That's not nice." I wanted her to know I was telling her the truth, so I retorted, "I'm not telling a story, Mama. I saw Daddy kissing the babysitter. Bobby saw him too." This is the moment when I learned not to tell Mama anything about Daddy. I thought when I told her the truth, that would be it for him. She'd put him out of the house and have nothing else to do with him anymore. He was doing what he wanted to do anyway. Furthermore, they weren't even together. He merely came around when he wanted to and simply stayed away as long as he wished to. Therefore, I thought this incident would make her disappointed enough to stand up to him and be done with him. I could see the hurt in her eyes as she struggled to keep her emotions together. And as she continued helping me to get ready, it had dawned on me what I'd done. I began to think, what if Mama told Daddy that I told her? What would he do to me? So I quickly blurted out, "Don't tell him, Mama. Please don't tell him." I felt I couldn't trust Mama and began to cry. She was going to tell Daddy I told her about him. She held me gently and whispered, "Hush. Stop your crying and get dressed for school. It'll be all right. I'll handle this." Mama walked straight out of our bedroom with confidence. As she walked into their bedroom, Daddy was still asleep. My stomach began to hurt as I heard her ask him, "Why were you kissing on the babysitter, Rob?" "Wake up. Bunny said she and Bobby saw you kissing the babysitter." She appeared to have confidence and was self-assured in her tone of voice. However, Daddy quickly broke her spirit, retorting, "What the hell are you talking about? Get off me. I did no such thing. Who told you that lie?" Mama's spirit was broken now, and I could hear that Daddy had the upper hand. Then I heard her blurt out, "Bunny and Bobby saw you, Bob. Your children were peeking at you through their bedroom door." I heard some brief scuffling, and then I heard Daddy walking towards my bedroom door with Mama right behind him. I ran to sit on the bed just before the curtain flew off the doorway. There was Daddy standing right there with Mama. She looked as if she didn't know what to expect. She ran past him hurriedly and got in front of me, trying to protect me. However, he conveniently moved her out of the way and began to harshly question me in his intimidating voice. "What's this I hear? Did you tell your mama you saw me kissing the babysitter?" Before I could even answer him, he sternly shouted, "You must have been dreaming. Answer me." As tears ran down my face, I tried to speak but had no assurance at all. He'd broken my spirit as well. I looked away from him and replied, "No, sir, I wasn't dreaming. I was awake. Bobby and I both saw you." He furiously yelled, "You little liar." Before I knew it, pow, he slapped me. My nose began to bleed. Mama saw what happened and she grabbed me, rushing me into the bathroom with Daddy following right behind her. He fussed at her for interfering with him. I looked at my mama as she put a cold cloth on my head to stop my nose from bleeding. She was scared, and I couldn't stand up to him. Then he said, "Tell your mother you're lying right now, and you owe us both an apology. Tell us both you're sorry." I saw Mama crying, held my head down and said, "I'm sorry, Mama and Daddy. I don't know why I lied." Mama kept telling me to hold my head back as she wiped my face. She wanted him to get away from me, so she instructed me to hold the wet cloth while she left the bathroom. Sure enough, he followed her back into their room, arguing the whole way. Suddenly, I heard him slap her and say, "Don't you ever get in the way of me chastising my children." After this incident, Mama told me she was sorry and that she believed me. She agreed with Daddy so he wouldn't go any further with it. She was remorseful and told me she didn't know he was going to go that far. She wished she'd never told him. I understood because I knew that Mama was just as afraid as I was. This is where I first saw that I couldn't get any help from my Mama. We couldn't even tell her the truth about Daddy. If we did, it wouldn't do us any good. No matter how much she prayed for him, it seemed to make no difference. The more she prayed, the worse Daddy would get. Sometime after, we moved downstairs from Aunt Ernestine. Mama was frying shrimp as a special treat for herself. She had her own recipe for the batter, and we loved it. But she was also trying to put us kids down for a nap. She wanted to go upstairs to visit her twin sister with the treat. On the other hand, Bobby and I were busy devising how to bribe Mama into giving us some shrimp since the younger ones had fallen asleep. We could smell the shrimp frying, and as she waited by the bedroom door, we could smell the shrimp frying as we waited by the bedroom door. Our plan was to persistently ask Mama for some shrimp until she gave in. Suddenly, we heard Daddy's voice coming towards the front door. Running back to the bed and laying down, we knew our chances for getting some shrimp were over now. We definitely weren't happy to see he'd come home. He immediately began fussing with Mama, and his voice kept getting louder and louder. At this time, he had a pickup truck and wanted her to go for a ride with him. Apparently, he didn't want to fuss at the house because my aunt and uncle could hear him. Since we moved downstairs for Mom and sisters, things were different. He couldn't just act a fool like he wanted to. Now, Daddy was insisting that Mama leave with him, but she felt like he was talking strange and was afraid to go. She didn't want to go with him alone, so she came into the bedroom, gathering up us children. She looked distraught as he followed her every step. "Let's go, Adeline. Get in the truck," he barked. Mama then instructed us to get in the truck too. She probably felt by us being with her, it stopped Daddy from being extreme. However, it didn't help. As we were riding, Daddy began hollering at her. She went into her usual routine, trying not to say anything until she had to. Only this time, there we were right in the middle of the chaos as he held little Randy on her lap. We'd never seen Daddy hit Mama before. We'd only heard it from our bedrooms or saw the bruises afterward. We'd merely heard her crying and begging him not to hit her anymore. But now we were in the truck with them and could see it all. He was going on and on directing his anger against Mama. I couldn't understand why he was so angry with her. She'd done nothing wrong. However, he was blaming her for not being able to see his family. None of it made any sense. He kept yelling at her, calling her names and saying it was all her fault. Mama was so confused. She'd never seen Daddy act like this before. We were all afraid, but he didn't seem to care. He just kept on taunting her, looking right over us like we weren't even there. In spite of the situation, I noticed when Daddy would stop at a traffic light, Mama would look out the window as if she were trying to get someone's attention. However, he was so involved in what was going on in his head, he didn't even notice what Mama was doing. He didn't see the people in the cars beside us watching him. They could see something was wrong as they kept driving up beside us. Regardless, Daddy went right on ranting and making gestures to hit Mama. As soon as the traffic light changed and he went to pull off, Mama opened the truck's door and jumped out. She literally jumped with little Randy in her arms and pregnant with Marty in her stomach. The car next to us slammed on their brakes and picked her up as Daddy went through the intersection before pulling over to the side. She was hurt and pleaded for them to take her to the hospital. Hysterically, she told them her husband was having a nervous breakdown. By the time Daddy got out of the truck, Mama was safely passing by in her rescuer's car. And when she got to the hospital, they called the police. Meanwhile, we were left behind with Daddy. We didn't know what was going on with Mama, and we were all crying. Realizing Mama was gone, he took us back to the house, instructed us to go upstairs to our aunt's house, and flew off like a bat out of hell. We ran to tell my aunt what happened, but had no idea where Daddy was going. Maybe he went to look for Mama? Aunt Ernestine was terribly frightened for Mama. She didn't know where Mama was and prayed that Mama would call. Come to find out, Daddy had gone to the hospital. He felt that's where Mama would be. He thought she had to have hurt herself when she jumped from the truck. He checked at the desk in the emergency room, where they directed him to the room she was in. At the time, the police were in the room talking to Mama. She cried uncontrollably, telling them her husband was having a nervous breakdown, adding that she wanted him to seek mental help. When the police saw Daddy, they stopped him from entering the room. They kept him in the hallway as they talked to him. They told him his wife wanted him to seek help and that she felt he was having a nervous breakdown. Nevertheless, Daddy turned it all around as he told the policeman that Mama needed help. He was very convincing with what he said, and they didn't know whose story to believe. Wow. Mama had sprained her arm and had it in a sling. Once the police left, Daddy came in the room, smoothly convincing her to leave with him. He apologized, promising her that he'd go and get help. So she ended up back in the truck with him, and he brought her home. Now, Mama truly believed Daddy when he said he'd get help. He stayed with her after he brought her home. Her arm was hurt, so he helped her with us. At the end of the day, it always seemed like Daddy would get his way, swindling his way back into Mama's heart. Mama prayed for Daddy to be saved. She wanted him in the church. She'd always say, "God's going to save my husband." This was her prayer all the time. I'd even hear her and grandma, aunts and uncles, even the saints at the church praying this prayer. In spite of that, Daddy seemed to get worse. Prayer didn't change a thing, and it just didn't look like he was getting better anytime soon. Chapter 7. Grandma wasn't playing. We learned about the Lord from Mama and her family and definitely got our talent from them. Mama was always singing around the house, writing and arranging songs of her own. Naturally, she taught us to sing the songs she'd written and arranged. Every holiday, we'd visit her family and the house would be filled with music. She was proud to show them the little songs she taught us to sing. They were surprised at how talented we were and how well we remembered our parts. We were so close to her family. They loved us and we loved them. Grandma was so precious and very special to us. She'd always come by our house checking on us. She bought us food and clothes that she bought from a sale because she knew Mama was having problems with Daddy. He was working, but we weren't benefiting from it, so she always kept an eye on us. Grandma was a sickly woman, but that didn't stop her. She'd often take the bus to come and visit each one of her children. Whenever she'd come, she'd always stay a while. I often wondered where Grandma really lived. She seemed to alternate from each of her daughter's houses. She was there for her girls whenever they'd have a baby and would stay around until they were well. It was a while before I learned that Grandma really lived with Aunt Clara. She was her eldest child, and Aunt Clara and Uncle Bill were the most financially stable. They took care of Grandma's needs and were good to her. Grandma was indeed loved. I'd see Grandma often because Mama was pregnant every year. Whenever she'd go to the hospital to have a baby, Grandma would come clean and cook for us. Mama really needed her help because Daddy was nowhere to be found. Grandma was a praying woman. Furthermore, she was Mama's prayer partner. She'd often quiet us down and sit us in a chair while they prayed together. Mama needed her mother for spiritual guidance, and Grandma was pleasant to be around. She had such a quiet and humble spirit. She'd even praise God quietly. I never heard her raise her voice. When Daddy was home with us, he even treated Grandma with great respect. Maybe it was because she was Mama's mother, or maybe he recognized her kindness and strength. Regardless, he walked a chalk line. Grandma had a way about her that would just calm your spirit. She could gently shame you into doing the right thing. When she left, though, he'd go back to his same old self again, making Mama miserable. We loved it when Grandma would come because the house would be intact. I remember a time Grandma was over our house and Daddy was fussing in his loud, boisterous voice. It seemed as if he wasn't even concerned that she was there. He arrogantly stormed through the house, hollering at us. Mama couldn't ask him anything without him snapping. Usually, he could contain his behavior when Grandma was there, but on this day, he couldn't stop. But I knew it was bothering Grandma, but she was trying her best to ignore it. He finally struck her nerve, and she'd had enough of his yelling. She leaned forward her chair and sternly said, "Bob, all that's not necessary. Why must you yell and raise your voice so loud? Now you need to stop that." Daddy looked at her and yelled, "What did you say?" Grandma wasn't going to be questioned, especially in that tone. She stood up and shook her finger at him, proceeding to shout back in the loudest voice I'd ever heard from her. "Don't you raise your voice at me, young man. You may scare Edeline, but you don't scare me. Now you lower your voice." Daddy was shocked. He got a rise out of Grandma that no one had ever seen before. He got quiet. He even apologized. Wow. What a blessed day. Daddy was scared of Grandma. He'd never heard her speak with such authority. Our eyes got big and filled with excitement. We all ran to sit under Grandma. We never, ever wanted Grandma to leave. But unfortunately, she had to go. And when the time came for her to go, I'd beg her to take me with her. Grandma didn't mind, and she'd always do her best to make it happen. I might have been afraid of our daddy, but Bobby was petrified of him. He'd study when Daddy would talk to him. Whenever Daddy wasn't around, Bobby hung underneath Mama. She'd call him her little man. But when Daddy was there, he resented Bobby always being around her. He'd torture Bobby, push him away, and tell him to go play. It sickened Daddy, and he'd slap him around. "Get away from your mama," he'd demand. "You're going to grow up to be a sissy boy, a little punk hanging under your mother." Bobby would stutter, "Yes, sir, daddy," and then he'd run off. He hated being afraid of Daddy. We all did. When we were away from him, we all had little things we'd say in secret, things we never wanted to get caught saying. We'd say we hated him and wished he'd die. However, Bobby would say he was going to kill him when he grew up. Even in our prayers at night, we'd pray that he'd leave and never come back. We hated that we had to love Daddy, and we couldn't understand why Mama wouldn't leave him. Why won't she get a divorce from him? Why does she keep having babies? Well, she believed in the church and her religion. The church didn't believe in divorce, and they didn't believe in birth control pills. So my mama was stuck. She wasn't going to backslide again. She felt she already messed up her life marrying Daddy. Therefore, she wasn't going to make it worse. The reality was, she was more afraid of going to hell than she was afraid of Daddy. Daddy Would Find Us, Chapter 8. Through our own eyes, we observed that Daddy's mother had said to Mama, I'm sorry. Wait, let me sit up. Okay. Through our own eyes, we observed what Daddy's mother had said to Mama about him. He was clearly showing signs of mental illness. We were victims of his anger and had no understanding of it. We were being mentally and physically abused to the point where it had simply become our way of life. Perhaps it had been Daddy's way of life as well. We'd never know. Who was there to tell us? We had no contact with his family. It would have been nice if we had some history on why Daddy would go into a fit of rage sometimes. Why did little things upset him? Why did Daddy put his hand through walls? He had his good days, but his bad days far outweighed them. They seemed to be few and far between. Despite all the red flags he'd already shown, Daddy was trying to do right for a change. It was around Christmas time, and he'd found a job. He was driving a truck for a furniture store. The store gave Daddy credit, and he surprised Mama by having some new furniture delivered to us. The agreement was they'd take the money from his check every week. Since we'd never had new furniture before, we were so proud. Mama and Daddy were looking forward to giving us children a wonderful Christmas. Lo and behold, after delivering the furniture, Daddy's co-workers told their boss that he had a black wife. As a result, Daddy lost his job, and the end result was Mama lost the furniture. The furniture company came back to our house to confiscate the furniture. This really hurt him. He could no longer provide for his family, and it was also embarrassing. When Daddy lost his job, he was now home all the time. He became depressed, being unable to pay the bills. He started drinking, and with his drinking, there came more fussing. He went back to accusing and fighting Mama again. Wow. However, it wasn't like the other times when he would leave and stay gone for a while. This time he was staying around the house and drinking. He was making our lives miserable. Mama was looking forward to the day he'd leave. By constantly picking fights, he was driving her crazy. I don't know how Edeline did this. I don't know how she put up with this. Okay, so my mind is going back to the time. I guess this is in the 1960s. don't know. Finally, the day came when Daddy left and she found some peace of mind. A few days later, in the middle of the night, he returned drunk. He banged and banged on the door for Mama to let him in, but she didn't want to be bothered. He was obviously drunk, and she knew what the end results would be. Of course, that didn't stop Daddy. He ended up going to her bedroom window. He whined and cried until he got tired. Then it got eerily quiet. Now, we thought he was gone, but suddenly we heard this big bang. Bam! Sounded like the ceiling had fell in. Shockingly, Daddy had kicked the back door in. Once he got in, he was furious. Mama got a beating for not letting him in the house. We were in our rooms crying uncontrollably, terrified of what he might do next. This terror would go on until he finally passed out. And when we got up the next morning, we saw the back door propped up where it used to be. This type of behavior would go on until Mama couldn't take anymore. Then she'd move over to my aunt's house. However, that would only last a few days. Just like clockwork, Daddy and Mama would make up. We'd look up and he'd be right there picking us up. He promised her that he'd stop his drinking and get another job. This had become a routine, and Mama decided she'd go one step further. The next time we left home to go to my aunt's house, Mama decided to look for another place. Once again, we looked up, and there he was at our doorstep. We were always moving to get away from him, but it was always in vain. Inevitably, Daddy would find us. The methods he'd take to find us were unbelievable. He'd go to the welfare office, convincing the people there into giving him our address. Then there were times we'd go to the hospital. He'd go to the hospital after he knew Mama had just delivered their baby. He played a proud father role and returned home with Mama. Mama would tell him he didn't, you know it. Daddy fixed that situation too. He'd go to the welfare office telling them that he was a husband who lived with her and could take care of her. Therefore, she no longer needed assistance. Since she was on welfare at the time, they cut her off. She knew nothing about it until her check didn't come. You see, Daddy wanted to make it hard on Mama. He wanted her to be totally dependent on him. As a result, we couldn't get rid of him. He always found some way to get back in. No matter where we were, Daddy would find us. Y'all see why I always talk about have your own shit? I see why my mama instilled that in me and my sister. Have your own shit. Now, I don't mind if you get married, but this is what you do. This is my mama talking. You can have a bank account with your husband, but have one on the side that the bank statements come to my house and you put money away. And don't let him know nothing about this bank account. Only you and I know. Now, remember, this is back in the day. There was no email and all that stuff. You had to get the statements in the mail. But that's what she taught us. Never depend on no man for nothing. She was adamant about that. We've heard that speech, that admonition over and over and over. I mean, we were 3 years old and she was telling us this shit. Chapter 9, Uncle Bill. When Aunt Clara moved to California, she took Grandma with her. I was so devastated when they left. Now I no longer have any grandma to take me away from the problems I was facing at home. Grandma was a diabetic and had to take insulin shots every day. Unfortunately, she also suffered with heart trouble. She worried a lot about her children. Obviously, Mama's situation was always on her mind. It was mind-boggling to her. Hell's mind-boggling to me. Aunt Clara felt Grandma was getting older, and for the sake of her health, she didn't need all the stress. She felt Grandma would do much better health-wise away from it all. As a result, Aunt Clara and Uncle Bill convinced Grandma to move with my aunt to Los Angeles. Grandma only agreed to be there for the winter months. She had to be able to visit her other children during the summer. Mama, who was now pregnant again, would have to bear this pregnancy without her mother. She missed her terribly and would write her all the time. She'd also have me write to her as well. I miss Grandma and enjoyed writing and receiving letters from her. I'd always make sure I'd send her pictures I'd drawn. Life just wasn't the same without Grandma with us. I look forward for the summer to come when I could see her again. Mama didn't live far away from her brothers and sisters, especially my Aunt Ernestine, her twin sister. Mama and her twin sister were very close. Everywhere we'd move, she lived within walking distance. They were both pregnant with their first child at the same time. I was 3 weeks older than my cousin Joni. Aunt Ernestine's daughter, Joni, and I would alternate spending the night at each other's house. She was like a sister to me, and I was glad she lived nearby. However, it still didn't take the place of my grandma. After Grandma left, Mama's family became involved even more in our lives. Aunt Ernestine was always around. I only got to see my other aunts and uncles on holidays. Since Grandma wasn't around to take me to visit them, they'd come and get me. I'd also spend the weekends with them sometimes. This was the privilege of being the only girl in my family. The boys could play with one another, but I had no females to play with. Therefore, I was allowed to go and spend the weekend with my female cousins. As a result, my Uncle Bill and Aunt Mamie became a big part of my life. Uncle Bill was a junior pastor at Bethel Pentecostal Church in Detroit. This was a church the whole family attended. He was a motivating uncle, a powerful man of God, and a great big brother. Mama and the family looked up to him. He was a prime example of where a black man could go in life. He was a man of integrity, a man of his word, spoke with great wisdom, and always had a kind word to say. Not only was he respected by his family, but the church members loved and respected him. You could tell he was destined for greatness in his walk. He was a God-fearing man who taught and walked the word. I've never seen Jesus, but I've seen Uncle Bill. To me, he was a perfect example of who Jesus was. I loved him dearly and would be mesmerized whenever I was in his presence. He was the perfect man, the perfect husband and father. In my eyes, he was the best-looking man in the world, always smelled good and dressed very classy. Uncle Bill would come to get me sometimes. He'd call Mama and tell her to have me ready. I'd spend the whole day with his family, and other times I spend the whole day with him. He'd bring me home with something new to wear and money in my pocket. He'd always ask me things Daddy wouldn't ask me, like, what did I want to be when I grew up? He'd encourage me and make me believe in myself. Most of all, he strengthened my little faith by telling me God sees everything and everything is going to be all right. I loved my Uncle Bill. He had children of his own and didn't have to take time out for me. Somehow he knew I needed him, and he was there for me. Not only was he there for me, but he was there for Mama and my brothers as well. He'd help her out by buying our outfits for Easter and Christmas. He made sure we had presents under the tree. Uncle Bill was our problem solver. Mama didn't have a job, so we were poor. We were on welfare and sometimes had very little to eat. So he'd always come by to bring us money and food. Then, before he'd leave, he put a dollar in each of our pockets. Mama couldn't always afford to get the boys' haircuts, so Uncle Bill was a barber. He'd take all the boys to his shop and cut their hair. We couldn't have asked for a better uncle in our lives. He was like a father to us. As a matter of fact, all of Mama's family was special to us. Aunt Clara is the one who actually nicknamed me Bunny. When she moved to California, she still remembered us. At Christmas time, a big box of presents came from her and Grandma in the mail. I thank God for Mama's family. They were all we had. There were many days they were there for us. They prayed for us, and their prayers are with us to this day. All right, chapter 10, Mama Teaches Us to Sing. Lisa said, my mother said the same thing. All right, now. Mama was determined to keep her dream of being a great gospel singer alive. But with so many children, singing in the choir wasn't an option. However, Mama had such a strong and beautiful voice, she'd frequently sing over the congregation. The saints would always tell her how beautiful she sang. It was nothing for her to pass a note to the usher requesting herself to sing. And when the pastor would honor the request, she'd get in the pulpit and tear the whole church down. If she didn't have children to raise, she definitely would have been part of a gospel group, traveling and singing. Even though having us held her back from her dream, she made the best of it and lived her dream through us. I knew it must have deeply saddened her to have such a beautiful voice and not be able to sing where and when she wanted. However, every time Daddy was gone, we'd wake up to Mama's music. When she was working around the house, she'd be singing a song also. Many times, it would be a song God just gave to her. Moreover, she was excellent at self-encouragement. With us following her lead, mimicking her as we'd sing behind her, she turned that into a positive, giving us little parts to sing along with her. She wasn't going to let her dream die. She made up for it by investing and embedding her dreams in us. She started with me. I was only 6 years old when she taught me to sing the Lord's Prayer. At Christmas, the Sunday school teachers handed out little poems for the children to learn and recite at the night service. Mama told the teacher that I'd be reciting a poem and singing. And then she rehearsed me on the song every day to get me ready. Finally, the night arrived, and Mama had rehearsed me well and put confidence in me. I'll never forget my first performance. When they called my name, I walked boldly before the church congregation and was given a real microphone, not like the hairbrushes we pretended with at home. This time it was for real. When I practiced with Mama, she told me to close my eyes, think about the goodness of Jesus, and just sing. See yourself at his feet, she'd say, then sing your heart out to him. I did just what Mama said. I closed my eyes, pictured myself at his feet, and sang my heart out. I held the notes Mama told me to hold, cut the notes where she told me to cut, and remembered every word. When I was done, I opened my eyes. The congregation were on their feet, giving me a standing ovation. They clapped their hands and praised God. And from that day on, I was known at the church as the little Debarge girl that could sing. Mama was beaming with pride for me that night and took pictures. When we wrote Grandma, she included them in the letter. Mama was so enthused with the way things came out with me singing, it gave her the incentive to get the boys singing. In the beginning, they didn't have the boldness I did to sing solo, so she formed a group. Bobby, Tommy, and I would sing around the house. She was teaching us parts and training our ears. Sometimes it would get on our nerves, but we had to be still. However, we loved music and loved to sing. She also taught me other songs, and I sang them at church too. Uncle Bill would have me sing whenever it was his Sunday to preach. Mama had a plan. She was going to teach us all she knew. She truly believed in her children from the very beginning, saw our talent, and invested in us. With each child she brought into the world, she gave them a voice. She put a hand on her stomach and prayed, "Dear God, get the glory out of this child's life. Use all of my children for your glory. Amen." All right, so that was 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. How long has I been at it? Do I see a time? I don't see a time. Huh. Should I continue? All right. I'll do one more chapter. Chapter 11, Double Life. It was summertime, and Grandma would soon be back in Michigan. The whole family was excitedly waiting for her arrival. Mama had a new baby boy, and Grandma had never seen him before. Even though I wanted a sister, once I saw my brother, I was content. He was the first baby I was old enough to hold. His name was Mark Duane, and he looked like a Chinese baby. He had slanted eyes and jet black hair that stood straight up on his head. His skin was an olive color like Indians, and he was darker than the rest of Mama's children. His little feet were turned in, and he was bow-legged. The doctor said it was the way Mama had carried him in her womb. They were waiting until he began walking. Then he'd have to wear braces to straighten his feet. Mama had good things to tell Grandma because she was finally happy with her marriage. She and Daddy were together again. He was looking for a job, stopped drinking, and was trying to be a good husband and father. As kids, we were uncomfortable with it. We lost faith in Daddy. However, Mama still had hope, and that's what we went on, her faith. We had no choice. We were children. It was what we had to do. After Grandma arrived in town, she was at our house often. She prayed with Mama that Daddy would get a good job, and it wasn't long before their prayers were answered. Daddy got a job as a truck driver at Massey Ferguson. The job called for him to drive long distance, delivering products to different companies. Grandma felt it was a good thing Daddy was on the road a lot. It gave Mama a rest between children. Mama didn't mind either. She trusted Daddy. He told Mama that the job called for him to sometimes stay in other cities. She had no idea what his hours were or when he'd be home, but at least he wasn't out drinking. He was on his job. And when he did come home, it'd be late and he'd leave early in the morning. We had no phone. Therefore, he wasn't able to call and check in. As a result, she had to go by what he told her. They were having happy times together. Her time with Daddy was short but pleasant. There was no more fussing and fighting going on. For the first time when he'd come home, we were all glad to see him. He'd plan family outings and we'd go on picnics to the park. He still wasn't in church, but Mama felt they were doing much better. Daddy was being a husband to her and a father to his children. She had no reason to doubt him. Even though he had a history of staying out in the past, this time we thought Daddy was at work. When he was gone, we thought he was working overtime. However, Daddy was living a double life. His overtime wasn't at Massey Ferguson's at all. Apparently, he was working overtime at another woman's house who lived just blocks away from us. At least you would have thought if Daddy was playing around, it would have been in another city. Sadly, a year had gone by, and Mama had no idea about Daddy being in another relationship, creeping around. The year was 1961, and Mama was pregnant again. It was her sixth pregnancy, and we'd outgrown the apartment we stayed in. Daddy moved us from the upstairs apartment to the lower level, which had an extra room. Mama had five children and one on the way. However, what Mama didn't know was Daddy now had six children and two on the way. When she found out, she was devastated. It was one thing for him to mess around, but to have children with another woman? Well, that just broke Mama's heart. He not only had another black woman he was living with, but she was having his babies too. Daddy's unfaithfulness began when Mama was pregnant with Mark. By the time Mama found out what was happening, the woman was pregnant again. Even worse, they were both pregnant at the same time. Daddy was taking care of two homes and two women. Apparently, his woman had other children as well. He'd been lying to her too. He told the woman that Mama and he were getting a divorce. Obviously, that wasn't true at all. He was just going back and forth between them both. They both found out how close they lived to one another. They even discovered they were pregnant at the same time, not just once, but twice. What a real son of a bitch. And I mean that literally. His mama was a bitch. He's just a real son of a bitch. A couple of months after Mark was born, my half-sister, I'm going to try to pronounce this word, I mean his name. A couple of months after Mark was born, my half-sister, Deathra, was born. Now, Mama was pregnant again, and so was the woman. The woman was very possessive of Daddy. She felt he belonged to her. I wish Adeline would have let that woman keep him and don't let nobody else have him. For real, that's what I would have told both of them. Keep this motherfucker to yourself, honey. So one day his woman came looking for him. She knew he was in town, maybe over at our house, and actually gathered up the nerve to drive down to our house to check her assumption out. She'd been drinking, which gave her even more courage than she already had. Mama's bedroom was at the back of the house. You could look out her window and see the alley. On this particular night, I was sleeping with Mama while she talked on the phone with her twin sister. I was awakened suddenly by a woman's voice shouting from the alley, "Bob, you better answer me. I know you in there." She was apparently angry and wanted Daddy to respond, but he wasn't at home with us. Mama hadn't even seen him herself. Then she yelled, "Adeline! Adeline!" Mama told her sister to hold on, and as she walked over and gazed out the window at his woman standing in the alleyway, seeing Mama in the window, she demanded, "Is Bob here? Where's my man, Adeline?" Mama chose to ignore her. She couldn't believe this woman was at her home asking for her husband. "I know you hear me." And then she called Mama out of her name. She told her to open up the door and let her in, barking she was going to whip her ass. She carried on and on, continuing to call Mama names and inviting her outside so they could fight. My aunt told Mama to call the police, but she didn't really want to do that. She knew the woman had been drinking and just wanted her to leave. Mama finally mustered up enough nerve before exploding, "Get away from my window. Go home. You've been drinking, and if you don't leave, I'll call the police." At first, she ignored Mama and refused to leave. So Mama gathered herself once more, as she sternly warned her. God is going to get you for messing around with a married man. Bob is my husband. You're just the other woman. That made the woman even angrier with Mama. She just kept cussing and inviting her outside to fight. But Mama wasn't a physical fighter. She was raised in a church. She was taught to turn the other cheek. She wasn't going outside to fight anyone. She just cried and prayed aloud. Lord, that's my husband. This woman is wrong for being here. She has no right to tell me to leave my husband alone. I know you see this, Lord. You'll fight my battles. I wouldn't walk outside and fight the other woman either. I'd walk outside and have a conversation with her, and we devise a plan on how she can keep Bob all to herself and don't let nobody else have him. That's what I would do. She was praying so loud the other woman could hear her praying to her God. Finally, the woman left the house and went back home. And when Daddy did come around, Mommy told him that his woman had been there and threatened her. It didn't make any difference, though. He still continued to go back and forth. However, he was with the other woman most of the time. He even asked Mama for a divorce, but she didn't believe in divorce. The white man gave you a way out, and you don't believe. Why would she block God's blessing? He even asked Mama for a divorce, but she didn't believe in divorce. I had a hunch that she still loved Daddy and just wasn't ready to let him go. I don't understand it. Occasionally, he'd come around to see Mama, but it was only to make sure he still had her. He had to live with the other woman. She was the type who would have got another man to jump on him. She didn't play that. She wasn't a church girl. Wouldn't you know, Daddy didn't fight her? Not like he fought Mama. This woman fought him back and had more in common with Daddy than Mama did. They drank together and did things Mama felt was a sin to do. Like what? I'm not going to dare express to you the thoughts that are going through my mind right now. But okay. Regardless, Mama wasn't giving up. She loved her husband and felt like that was what God wanted her to do. Therefore, she accepted him back every now and then, excusing the fact that he was with this other woman. Mama just left it in God's hands. Feeling there was nothing she could do, she simply trusted in him to see her through. All right. Yeah, let me just put this down for a while. We will continue chapter 12 the next round. So far, I don't get it. You know, the best way not to get pregnant is not to have sex at all. And how could you give it up to a man that gives you a black eye, beats you in front of your children? How do you get moist for that? I don't get it. I would dry up like the Sahara Desert. He would never be able to enter. Get away from me. In fact, I would encourage him to go get another woman. Go leave, be with her. But hey, what do I know? That's just me. So far, what do you think about this book? Leave your thoughts in the comment section. Have you learned anything thus far? If so, what would that be? I'm interested in hearing your thoughts, reading your thoughts. All right. Thank you so much for tuning in. Please feel free to Cash App Madam Whipass on a dollar sign. All Cash Apps will go to the Jumanji and Diva Stainless Steel Cage Fund. All right. Thanks again. And I'll see you soon. Wait, how about one more song? Since they kept sexing and having all these babies, let's find a song that coincides with that. I don't know. But yeah, they was doing it and doing it and doing it wild. But that's not the song I'm going to play. I'm going to play. Wait. Hold on. I'm going to play this one. Got to go here. And I got to do this. And I got to do that. And do that. And share. And here we go.
Oh, Thank you. Baby. to me. There's no place I'd rather you be than with me. Such enough as I'm in the spirit.